Imagine a world where the line between human and machine blurs, where we can enhance our physical and cognitive abilities, even achieve a form of digital immortality. Sounds like science fiction, right? But what if I told you that some of the brightest minds of our time believe this could be our reality in the not-so-distant future? Before we go into the future, let's rewind a bit. 70,000 years ago, our human ancestors were just another species of animal, minding their own business in a corner of Africa. Fast forward to today, and it's clear that humans have come to dominate planet Earth. We've spread to every continent, and our actions determine the fate of other animals, and possibly Earth itself. So, how did we get from there to here? According to historian Yuval Noah Harari, we are the only animal that can cooperate on a massive scale and conjure up ideas and concepts that exist solely in the realm of our imagination.
All the huge achievements of humankind throughout history, whether it's building the pyramids or flying to the moon, have been based not on individual abilities, but on this ability to cooperate flexibly in large numbers. The next question that immediately arises in the mind of inquisitive listener is, how exactly do we do it? What enables us, alone of all the animals, to cooperate in such a way? The answer is our imagination. We can cooperate flexibly with countless numbers of strangers because we alone, of all the animals on the planet, can create and believe fictions, fictional stories. And as long as everybody believes in the same fiction, everybody obeys and follows the same rules, the same norms, the same values. All other animals use their communication system only to describe reality. A chimpanzee may say, look, there is a lion, let's run away. Oh, look, there is a banana tree over there, let's go and get bananas. Humans, in contrast, use their language not merely to describe reality, but also to create new realities, fictional realities. We humans control the world because we live in a dual reality. All other animals live in an objective reality. Their reality consists of objective entities like rivers and trees and lions and elephants. We humans, we also live in an objective reality. In our world too, there are rivers and trees and lions and elephants. But over the centuries, we have constructed on top of this objective reality a second layer of fictional reality, a reality made of fictional entities, like nations, like gods, like money, like corporations. And what is amazing, that as history unfolded, this fictional reality became more and more powerful, so that today, the most powerful forces in the world are these fictional entities.
Our imaginations and creative thinking have been instrumental in designing and developing tools throughout human history. From the creation of the wheel, the discovery of fire, the invention of the printing press, and the development of the internet, our ability to envision better ways of doing things and solve problems has driven our technological progress. It allowed us to create AI systems that can process vast amounts of information at speeds impossible for a human, make complex calculations in fractions of a second, and even learn and improve over time, showing a level of adaptability that was once uniquely human. And what implications could these advancements hold for us as individuals, for our societies, and for our understanding of what it means to be human?
So many things are being said now about AI, but I think there are two things that every person should know about AI. First is that AI is the first tool in history that can make decisions by itself. All previous tools in history couldn't make decisions. This is why they empowered us. You invent a knife, you invent an atom bomb. The atom bomb cannot decide to start a war, cannot decide which city to bomb. AI can make decisions by itself. Autonomous weapon systems can decide by themselves who to kill, who to bomb. The second thing is that AI is the first tool in history that can create new ideas. The printing press could print our ideas, but could not create new ideas. AI can create new ideas entirely by itself. This is unprecedented. Therefore, it is the first technology in history that instead of giving power to humans, it takes power away from us. And the danger is that it will increasingly take more and more power from us until we are left helpless and clueless about what is happening in the world. And this is already beginning to happen in an accelerated pace. More and more decisions about our lives, whether to give us a loan, whether to give us a mortgage, whether to give us a job, are taken by AI. And more of the ideas, of the images, of the stories that surround us and shape our minds, our world, are produced or created by AI, not by human beings.
We are on the verge of allowing life to break out for the first time from the organic realm into the inorganic and creating the first inorganic life forms after 4 billion years of evolution.
Our species, Homo sapiens, I don't think we'll be around in a century or two. We could destroy ourselves in a nuclear war, through ecological collapse, by giving too much power to AI that goes out of our control. But if we survive, we'll probably have so much power that we will change ourselves using various technologies so that our descendants will no longer be Homo sapiens like us. They will be more different from us than we are different from Neanderthals. People will use the new technologies, trying to upgrade humans, but actually downgrading them. This is a very, very big danger. If you let corporations and armies and ruthless politicians change humans using tools like AI and bioengineering, it's very likely that they will try to enhance a few human qualities that they need, like intelligence and discipline, while neglecting what are potentially more important human qualities, like compassion, like autistic sensitivity, like spirituality.
Harari also warns of a new kind of inequality, where those who can afford these enhancements become a superior class of beings, leaving the rest behind. As Harari warns, one of the big dangers which more and more experts are talking about is that in the next few decades, artificial intelligence will push humans out of the job market and create a new massive class, the useless class, people who have no economic usefulness, because AI outperforms them in almost all tasks. He proposes that these technological advancements could lead to the creation of a new kind of human, a godlike being with enhanced abilities, possibly even immortality. These visions of the future are as fascinating as they are challenging. If we can enhance our brains and bodies, should we? If we can achieve digital immortality, should we? And who gets to decide? The future, as seen by Harari, is a place of incredible potential, but also of significant risks.
Over the last 10 years, we have creating machines for grabbing people's attention. This is what has been happening on social media. Now we are designing machines for grabbing human intimacy, which in many ways it's much, much more dangerous and scary. Already the machines for grabbing attention, we've seen how much social and political damage they could do by distorting the public conversation. Machines that are superhuman in their abilities to create intimate relationships, this is like psychological and social weapons of mass destruction. If we don't regulate it, if we don't train ourselves to deal with it, it could destroy the foundations of human society. Because basically, we don't understand ourselves. I mean, as long as we don't understand our brain, our body, our mind, it's a very, very bad idea to start manipulating a system that you don't understand deeply, and we don't understand ourselves.
As we redefine what it means to be human, we must also redefine our values, our ethics, and our societies to ensure that our technological advancements serve us rather than the other way around. The actual future will depend on a multitude of factors, including how we manage and regulate AI development, societal responses, and unforeseen technological advancements. In the end, the future will be what we make of it. As Harari suggests, the future could be a place of incredible wonder and potential, but it's up to us to guide that potential in a way that is beneficial and equitable. The future may be post-human, but it will always be a product of human choices and actions. So, let's make those choices wisely, for the future is closer than we think.